back for a second week here on Road Trip. We are back here at the same location for week number two. What's the week two? It's the second half of Lawrence and Arline Sieler's interview with the former mayor of Montpelier, Vermont, and a member of the Senate of Vermont. Her name is Anne Watson. The second half of our Able and On Air series double play. Stick around from Avenue X, West 3rd Street, here in the heart of Brooklyn. I'm Ron Rondon, and this is Road Trip.
For almost 7 years, I was behind the internet microphone, the weekend host of the number one sports show, Sports Fan.
That's why you can't stand my friend being crazy now.
Welcome to Road Trip. Thanks for joining us. Hope you enjoy the whole Labor Day weekend last week. And I know I am all psyched up for football because football season just started yesterday and today. Why today? Because the first opening week of the NFL is held over in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, when the Green Bay Packers take on the Philadelphia Eagles. It's the match that I think you've been asking about, but it's good to see it anyway. I hope you enjoyed this incredible football game, and now you came right here to me to start off another episode of Road Trip. And today, it's part two. And
good, why awesome. Part two?
Thank you very much. Anyway, part two today, it's definitely a lot of fun because this is part two of our Able On Air series, and it's part two of the interview with Lawrence and Arline Sieler, and their guest is Anne Watson. He is a former mayor of the state of Montpelier, Vermont, and also member of the United States Senate in Vermont. Now, we had so much issues about transit, housing, and everything. There's a lot of issues that you want to tap into in their energy. So what we're going to do is this. Take a quick break, do some business over there, and then come right back and hear more of Annie Washington, very new, as Able and On Air Marathon returns. Stick around, there's a lot more here on Road Trip.
I never heard the word before my doctor told me I had emphysema. The two-block walk from the house to the subway was knocking me out. I was breathing like a steam engine. I thought maybe I was just out of shape or getting a little old or something, but I'm not that old. I'm a pretty active guy, and I was pretty active, and I'm taking treatments, and I'm learning how to breathe all over again. It's going to be a long haul, but I really have no choice.
Emphysema is a lung disease that can be treated and alleviated if dealt with in time. The first symptoms might be shortness of breath after normal minor exertion. If you suffer such symptoms, see your doctor. It's a matter of life and breath.
Environment, people with special needs, like, because Vermont has so much greenery.
Yeah.
So how is that changing, you know, with new things happening in environment?
Well, so did you have something in mind particularly?
Or? No, like, okay, environmental, how can I word this? You had the event with the electric cars, but
yes.
how in terms of special needs, like, Are, in your opinion, are people with special needs affected by environment when it comes to their own challenges, or?
Oh, sure. No, I mean, we know that particularly people.
That's the way I wanted to word it. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Fair enough. Or folks that are typically minorities, and whether that includes disability or not, are often that is the population that is most affected by pollution, mm-hmm. And just other like environmental injustices. And so
lead poisoning, etc.
Sure. Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah, all kinds of poison.
Especially when it comes to the upgrading of homes and weatherization. If someone needs to be able to live in a certain accessibility scale home, mm-hmm. It's really important that those homes are weatherized, for example, and have proper ventilation along with them.
Mm-hmm.
So. That's one thing that comes to mind, mm-hmm. for sure.
Mm.
There's actually one other thing I want to,
Go ahead.
One of the other factors in terms of the environment, as we move towards a more sustainable future, for Vermonters, roughly a third of the energy that the average Vermonter expends is in transportation. And so the
How
more,
so?
Well, because a lot of Vermonters just live way out, in the country, and so they end up having to drive a half an hour to anywhere, anything.
Some Vermonters probably don't have, I haven't experienced it, but mm-hmm. some Vermonters probably don't, in rural Vermont, probably don't have a grocery or they have a little mom and pop store. And
sure.
They don't have,
or if they want to get to a grocery store, it's 30 or 40 minutes away. Yeah, for sure. And so we know that places that are more sustainable, just in general, are going to be places that are more highly densely populated, which, as far as I understand, is actually going to make it easier for those with disabilities to get around, whether it's living in town and being able to walk or, be able to take their wheelchair around town to the places where they need to go, or whether that's even having a high enough density population to make public transit or mass transit a viable option. So that's something I certainly have been thinking a lot about lately.
Let's talk a little bit about the new down street building that's happening along with the bus depot.
Mm-hmm.
Can you talk a little bit, accessible housing, I understand, 30 units?
Yes.
And then
the
bus depot?
Right, so the bus depot will be on the first floor, and then there's three levels of, I think it's mixed income and affordable housing above that, which is very exciting. It's great to see.
More housing is popping up because the French block took a while, and then you have this, and
it's just so encouraging to see all the new housing going into Montpelier. It's really great.
Do you think? Now I understand that they're trying to get rid of homelessness within 2020. You think the 30 units is a step in the right direction?
Oh, it's definitely a step in the right direction. Is that going to solve homelessness? Certainly not.
No.
In fact, I think that is going to take some pretty significant system shifts.
Shifts,
yeah, just changes in many levels of our system to help end homelessness.
Mm-hmm.
And in part that, my understanding of that is that that's going to involve shifts to the minimum wage, to the healthcare system, to supports for mental health, for other kinds of disabilities, and so it's going to take a lot, but having more housing available, I think is going to be good, and will probably increase the density in Montpelier, which is mm-hmm. a good thing.
Okay, let's talk about mental health services.
Sure.
I understand that back in the summer there was an incident that happened in Montpelier with Mark Johnson.
Yeah.
And we did a couple of shows about gun violence to kind of educate people.
Yeah. Thank you for doing that, by the way.
You're most welcome. What is the status on how police officers in Montpelier and neighboring towns, how are they working to educate more people with mental health situations and working with the police? I mean, if that's the right wording of the question.
Sure. So the Montpelier police do go through mental health training. Mm-hmm. Now, to be fair, that investigation is ongoing.
Still ongoing.
And it's still open. Mm-hmm. And so I'm hopeful that it will wrap up soon. So actually once it's wrapped up, we're planning on having some time during a city council meeting specifically to address this. I mean, we had actually talked about...
I'm sorry.
It's okay.
I know that Disability Rights Vermont just started a memorial fund on behalf of mm-hmm. Mark Johnson.
Yeah, so, which is wonderful. And actually someone came to a council meeting the other day to talk about that, which was really moving. It was a lovely talk that the gentleman gave.
So do you think there should be more training with police officers or more nonviolent ways to work with people with mental illness, or?
So I think there's always room for improvement just in general. But I'm going to say specifically, let's
Radio
talk about that more
WCBS
once that report comes
FM
out, because then I think we can really get into some of the details of what happened, and if there was a breakdown of anything, you know, we can identify it and then think through like what could have happened differently.
Mm-hmm.
So let's if you don't mind my taking a rain check on that.
No
but
problem.
Having said that, I think there are always ways to be better and to improve.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, anything new other than what you've spoken about that you would like to mention?
Oh, sure. Well, you mentioned the transit center is going to be opening pretty soon. And the housing as well, very exciting. But then the other thing that I think is worth mentioning is that the shared use path that will go across town, a major portion of it is about to be officially opened as well.
The bike path.
Yes.
Has the bike path taken? Because I remember there used to be a Montpelier beverage place.
Yep.
Has that taken over that particular space?
The bike path?
Yeah.
Yes. So, but there's a couple of things that are going on with that space. So part of that lot will be used for the bike path.
Mm-hmm.
And we're sort of, there's no work happening right there at this very moment because we're waiting to do some environmental testing.
Do you mean by environmental testing?
Oh, they're looking for contaminants in the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And then once we know that, we'll be able to move forward. Anyway, but just next to where the shared use path will come through will be the road that is like the access road to behind like the drawing board and Shaw's.
Oh.
Not Shaw's, I'm sorry. The drawing board and Aubuchon's.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
Gets its parking lot.
Yep, and so and then the space that used to be a parking lot right next to the beverage center building, that we're just gonna seed over with grass for now.
So there'll be no more beverage center planning, I guess, or
well,
planned.
Well, so we had we're actually still in the process of looking for a place that could be a beverage redemption center.
Because the only one now is in Barrie.
I know.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's terribly inconvenient for me. I mean, I have to drive my bottles to Barrie. That's not, I mean, I would prefer to just have it be right at the corner of Barrie.
Yeah, my husband takes it back to Shaw's.
yeah, you can take them to Shaw's.
Yeah,
that's true.
Yeah.
Anyway, there's quite a few reasons as to why we haven't been able to find a new place for it yet, but we're still actively looking. And my understanding is that it's easiest or it's easier to have a beverage redemption incorporated into another existing business.
Okay.
So it's still ongoing. And actually, we're going to get a new executive director for the Montpelier Development Corporation starting in November.
Wow.
And so I hope to put that on.
Our next guest.
Yeah, you should definitely have her on. She's great. Her name is Lisa Maxwell, and she's going to be starting in November.
Okay.
So. I'll tell you something, that is a lot of good to talk about all these issues that Griffith said, mostly in Vermont, mostly in upstate New York, Western New York, maybe here in New York, it's both going to be the same thing. Anyway, when we come back, we'll have the climatic conclusion with Annie Watson. Right here on
I was surprised how easy it was to get a good, low-cost health plan.
Choose yours today. You might even get help paying for yours.
Go to nystateofhealth.ny.gov or call 1-855-355-5777.
This is News Radio 88 WCBS FM New York.
I understand that certain traffic lights in Montpelier, when you push them, they speak.
Yep.
You know, for the blind or people that can't hear well.
Mm-hmm.
And there's one traffic light by the end where Shores is that, if you know what I'm talking about, it's a yellow-looking pole, and you push it.
And it flashes.
Flashes.
Yep.
Is there anything within the city's budget about putting more of those? Because I think it would help, I myself deal with a visual impairment, so it would help people with visual impairments to have more.
Yeah, fair. So that was funded through the Montpelier Transportation Infrastructure Committee.
Yes.
And so they have a certain budget that they allocate every year. And they're also trying to, they work in coordination with something called the Complete Streets Plan.
Yes.
And so I would have to look at the Complete Streets Plan or talk to the Transportation Infrastructure Committee to, or actually there's also a committee for the Complete Streets, so I could talk to them as well, but see about what the plan was for more of those. But I should mention that the city also just adopted a vision for a few of the intersections actually in Montpelier. So one of them was, the plan anyway, is to put a street light at the corner of Berry and Main Street.
Where's Berry and, what do you mean?
So by Shaw's, where that flashing yellow sign is, we're gonna also probably put in a, the vision is to put in a street light there.
And if I can make a suggestion.
Sure.
At night, you know, sometimes at night I have to wear a reflector when I go out. But at night it would be good because I understand that those lines, you know, the street crosswalks are not painted over, you know, some of them fade.
Yeah.
So it would be good to have reflectors for people like, or reflecting paint, maybe, that can glow. So if you need to walk, you can see where you're going.
Yeah, it seems like a great suggestion.
Yeah.
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 I'll have to talk to Donna about that one.
Okay. Yeah. And so going into the future of your campaign, what is your view with the current situation and going forth about, let's say, the ADA committee, if you want to talk about a little bit about that or anything else within your campaign?
Sure. Talk about my campaign a little bit. I mean, I will be probably officially announcing in November that I'm going to be running for mayor again. But that is the plan. So hoping to be mayor again for another term. And that, you know, just in terms of what your question was about the, you know, the thoughts about like ADA plans moving forward. So we just this last year, within the last couple of months, actually, got an ADA master plan for the city, which is great. Now, of course, there's so much in there that's very expensive that we can't do it all at once.
But like what, for example?
I'm sorry?
Like what, for example?
Give
some examples.
Well, sure. So actually one of the things that I know is going to... I can think of a few things off the top of my head. For example, there are a number of municipal buildings that don't have access ramps. For example, the wastewater or the water resource recovery facility, for example, doesn't have a ramp. That needs to change. But there's a whole wonderful list of things that need to be done. Another one that I know is going to come up in the near future is the rec building. So the city just decided to not build a new rec facility, but to rehabilitate the existing one.
And so what's wrong with the existing one?
Oh my goodness, so many things. I shouldn't say it like that. It needs a lot of work. It's a great building with great bones to it, and I think with the right investment, it could be just amazing. For example, I think there's some asbestos issues in there. I look forward to converting that building to a renewable heating source. There's not great ADA access to that building, and that I know is going to be a really important factor when we consider how to rehabilitate that building, is how to make it fully ADA accessible.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one.
Will it ever be where everything, because I know some restaurants are still not accessible within Montpelier. I know we're supposed to be ADA compliant.
Mm-hmm.
Do you think everything, I know a little bit at a time, I understand.
Yeah.
But do you think, will there ever be a time in Montpelier where everything will be accessible?
Well, one hopes, right, of course, but I think the answer to that is that it will, even if we're able to check off all the things on that list, undoubtedly there will be... Mm-hmm. There will continue to be challenges.
Where business owners because you're sectioning off, like, I'm not mentioning businesses, I wouldn't do that.
Sure.
Right.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. But your people with special needs deserve a right to go into a restaurant on a Saturday night and have a meal.
Yeah.
And if they can't get into if they can't get into the restaurant because it's too narrow, mm-hmm. or they're having problems getting in, then it's loss of revenue for people.
So just to be clear, the city's master plan is strictly for municipal infrastructure. So our
I'm
plan.
Sorry.
No, it's okay. I just want to make sure that I wasn't misleading or anything. So the city's plan is just for municipal buildings, and so it's that does not include things like making restaurants or other establishments.
I don't think it's fair, but
yeah, no, that was fair. Yeah, that's a good observation. Mm-hmm. And so how do we encourage or incentivize buildings to when they do renovations potentially to also include ADA modifications as well?
Mm-hmm.
And my understanding is that there is some requirement that if you have a renovation of a certain size that a business may be required to put some of that towards ADA compliance.
Mm-hmm.
That's a long time. But even so, even if all the restaurants were ADA compliant, we were talking about the sidewalk cracks earlier. That is just going to be a continual thing like a perennial problem that we're going to need to keep our eyes on and make sure that we're funding properly in a way that is able to address them. But we might find ourselves in a time like right now where, we're probably a couple of weeks out. Actually, I think there was a frost warning recently, but either it was recently or it's not far along, where basically we're not going to be doing any more sidewalk work, generally speaking, over the winter. And so over the winter things will probably get worse, and then we'll try to fix it when the weather breaks, just because that's the climate we live in. But that will be a continual process.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, anything else you want to mention before we...
No, I think that's it.
Okay. Any more questions?
No.
Okay. Well, we'd like to thank you, Mayor Anne Watson and Teacher Anne Watson.
Well, thank you.
For, you know, I mean, you got to give a plug to Montpelier High School.
Yeah, right.
We'd like to thank you for joining us on this edition again.
For
Abled and On Air. I'm Lawrence Sieler.
I'm Arline Sieler.
See you next time.
All right, folks, there it is. Abled and On Air. Hey, yeah, a lot of good issues, a lot of good talk with our terrific guest, Anne Watson. Thank you, Anne Watson, for being with us. And of course, to Lawrence and Arline Sieler for being hosting the show with the support. And by the way, listen, Lawrence, thank you for having me on the show. His show, Abled and On Air, live. That was taped last Tuesday over in the studio, and I was here in Brooklyn. Stay tuned for an upcoming episode of this complete interview and another guest as well. And don't forget, if you want more Abled and On Air, here's what you gotta do. Just go to the Facebook or YouTube page, and look up the word Abled and On Air on the past episode of the past year. And also check out all past episodes during Abled and On Air on Growth of the Ron Rodden TV Show. Also on YouTube, featuring some of my previous appearances on the show. Check it out. In the meantime, you check out next, Sci-Fi Ninja Theater, another episode for the 2022 Chiller Theater. That's coming up next. And if you're an alien one person, Neil Consultant has Alien Extinction Talk coming up next at 5 a.m. And don't forget to check out Game Show Block Party late tomorrow night. Oh, Sunday morning from 1 to 1:30 a.m. And Sunday from 4:30 p.m. to 1 p.m.
Very interesting.
This is Don Wilson saying good night.